Itself is called Surabaya Memory. So it's part of a bigger project that we call Desa Informasi. Desa means village. So it's an information village. That's the name of the umbrella project. And one of the sub-project is called Surabaya Memory. Okay, please. Aims and objectives, there are only two, actually. The first is to provide digital documentation of Surabaya City's heritage. And then the second is kind of a more general objective, is to educate the society and increase awareness of heritage preservation. But the first objective is the main focus of the library. And but then we then expand that into the second objective. And then the methodology is that we use our expertise as librarians and also across libraries to gather, organize, and disseminate information and learning resources. And then second and third is relatively the same, that we educate our user and by creating educational events. How we do that, that's what I'm about to share to you. Next. I will talk about this, all these four. How we develop the digital library, how we develop the website, and how we develop educational events for achieving those two objectives. Next. Digital resources now. When I talk about resources in this context, I mean digital resources. First, mainly consists of old photographs. I mean old photographs of our city, Surabaya, and then it can also consist old maps. But then it can also include documentation projects. I mean architectural or traditional settlements, markets, or any documentation that relates to the development of our city. Okay, so it doesn't have to be old pictures, it doesn't have to be old maps, it doesn't have to be old documents, as long as it relates to our city. And then, artistic works. So we collect not only scientific quote-unquote resources, but also artistic, but with the documentary value. So we don't just collect the resources just for the sake of the artistic value, but instead for the sake of the documentary values. And then the last is we try to develop these digital resources collaboratively with the people of Surabaya. So we try as much as possible not only to limit the project into the library, okay, but we try to involve as much as possible people from outside of the library. Okay? The search engine and directory. So this is just to show you, to give you, and if we have time and you want to see, I don't know if it's connected to the internet, maybe if we just have time. Okay, this is the search engine, and then next, this is the directory. So basically, if you don't know what you want to see, if you want to look for something, then just go to the directory and everything is there. Next. And then these are some of the resources. Mostly old pictures, but then as you can see on the left side is a painting by one of the artists in Surabaya. And since I emphasize that we focus mainly on the art documentary value, so that means we select this artist based on the fact that before he did any paintings, he always did researches about our city. What are the buildings look like, what are the color of the cars, for example, during that time. Okay, and then still some samples, a picture of the one of the oldest Chinese temple in Surabaya, and then the sketches from one of the very famous artists in our city. Next, and also about human interest. So the left hand picture is about the Arab quarters in our city, and then the interesting thing is about the pictures that depict people's life. So the right hand picture is a picture of someone from the ethnic group that we call Maduranese, and during the old times, this ethnic always translate that they occupy a certain type of occupations, including the food sellers, and not only just any kind of food, but certain food sellers. So it brings also history in the picture. Next. Now, with those are the traditional quote unquote resources, everything that looks old, something like that. But then we have a local history content from unlikely resources, visual communication design projects. What it is? Maybe just click that. So these are the kind of what I call is next new genre of local history resources. Why? Because these resources were not intended to be a historical document. Instead, they were created for the from the perspective of the design. These resources were created by the students from the Faculty of Art and Design. So logically, they would emphasize on how to create a good design. But then, since they selected the topic about figures of Surabaya, I mean, an influential figures of Surabaya, artists of Surabaya. So the students had to do some researches about those characters, those people. And in doing that, unintentionally, they also produced some kind of a local history content into that works. So this is what I call the new genre. The content itself is, you can say, is a local history, but the appearance is very contemporary. Next. We also, recently, we also included the documentation of traditional settlements. This particular content we gathered from the Department of Architecture. They had a special assignment for the students to document traditional settlement, traditional markets, and everything that's local in Surabaya area. And it happened during the 90s and 80s. And now these places are not there anymore. Mostly are being, what you call that, obliterated by the development of the city. But then we still keep the documentation. And this is very interesting because the department wanted to throw away all the documents because they don't have the space, but the library saw this as an opportunity because why should you throw them away? It's kind of a good mine for us, a corpus of information that needs effort in gathering them. Why should you throw them away? So we digitize them. Okay? And also relatively new kind of resources also about green map, also from the Department of Architecture. And this is a bit more interesting because not only the final product, but also the process of producing this kind of resources is also very interesting because, for example, if you want to produce a green map, maybe our colleagues from the architecture department here know what green map is, but for the ones who might not be aware of that, green map is anything that very local. For example, for Surabaya area, we could produce any kind of green maps. For example, let's produce a green map for places where we could have traditional houses that still survive, okay? We could produce a green map for that. And we should involve local people in producing this kind of green map. By involving them, we also increase awareness of these local people on and about their surroundings. Increase awareness, and then in terms it will translate into better understanding about the city heritage. And this is a very interesting resources that was recently it will be added soon in the collection. Next. And also just to make things more interesting for the young people, because our university is mainly an undergraduate teaching university, so we have to make this kind of resources more appealing to the students by just providing links or facility for them to easily connect the resources to their Facebook page. Okay. And so far, we want to include these resources as much as possible into the teaching and learning process. I cannot say that we have managed to do that well, but at least some positive indications are leading into that way. For example, we have the architecture department, tourism and leisure management, and hotel management. These three academic departments have been using those kind of resources into their teaching and learning process, although not integrated into the online learning system, it's still separate. So we still have a separate system for the digital library system, and then we still have a separate system for the online learning management. And it is our hope that in the near future, we can link both systems. And other uses, of course, for personal reasons, for book publishing. So we have had requests for book publishing that will be incorporating some of our resources into the upcoming book publication. City Maps also, the city government also uses some of our resources into the production of their free city guide or something like that. Next. And this is a bit interesting. Usually we have a physical collection and then we have digital collection, but in this case the Surabaya Memory Project was started as a digital project, but then it evolved into also the creation of a physical collection. So lately we we purchased some old books in Dutch, because old books about Surabaya were written in Dutch mainly. So we acquired those resources, the physical books. And challenges. The first challenge is the most difficult one. How we could encourage public participation in the collection development. There are two reasons for this. First is, three. Lack of culture for sharing resources. This happens in most Asian countries, that people tend to keep to themselves the resources that they have. And then the second is because the heritage resources often mean business for someone. For example, if you have a private photo collection of the old Surabaya, you might not want to share them with us or with others, because you could generate income from that. You can produce postcards, you can produce any kind of promotional material from that resources. And then third is that usually the people who have those kind of collection are usually big collectors, and they don't, even though they don't need the money, but they don't want to share them because they want it to be personal for their own enjoyment. So, and some strategies that I would offer, but I would skip this, so let's next. Okay. And those are about the digital collections and the traditional collection, the physical collection. But now, for educating the society, we want to make this collection, the digital collection, to be approachable, or to be near, to be accessible. Thank you for the society in general. So we produce website, we use exhibitions, and then we use next. We provide also heritage walks, competition, anything that's fun. We even also produce merchandises, and then next. And we involve as much as possible various communities, stakeholders, next. These are, next, this is our website that give you information about our current and upcoming exhibitions, any new information, next. And these are some of the merchandises, just to make things more fun. I mean, heritage not to be something oldish or something, but can be something fun, okay? Next. It's a bit dark in there. But this is one of the heritage work that we conduct every year. We have about 3 to 4 heritage walks annually, and we give theme for each of the heritage walk. We have the journey to the past, meaning that it will concentrate, the heritage walk will concentrate on the old part of the town, which means mostly Dutch colonial era. So you can see Dutch architecture, buildings, and Dutch style buildings, something like that. But then we also have next, we have the tour the kampungs. It means that the heritage walk will be going to the remaining traditional kampungs that we still have left, very few in Surabaya. And sometimes we went into the real home of people. Of course, we did preliminary survey asking the permission whether it's okay for the participants to go into the traditional homes to see how they manage their home, how they live in everyday life. And we also have heroic traits because Surabaya is known for heroic city. Okay, time is up, so I'll just pass. This is a photo exhibition, and yes, just skip. It has become a collaboration platform for different campus units. So it was started by as a library project, but now it involves several different academic departments as well. And then the challenges, I'll skip there. Okay, next. And these are some of the programs, competition for children, next. Traditional dance, next. And then exhibition, we hold exhibition in malls, not in at campus, because we want to reach to the common people. Next. And entertainment activities and educating the society for school children. They have to look for clues in the old pictures, and by then they will learn something about the history of the city. Next. Institutional visibility, increase networking, contribute to the webometrics. If you want to know webometrics, it's a ranking of university based on digital resources. Media coverage, of course, next. Online uses, we'll skip this because time's up. Conclusion. So, an open heritage repository like this can be used to add appeal to formerly neglected oldest resources, provide learning resources for campus community, facilitate collaboration among different campus units, so it's not just a library, and then facilitate as an outreach platform, so the library and all these different departments can work together to outreach to the society, and then, of course, expand library's sphere of influence on campus and in the society, and function as silent marketing. And last but not least, next, this is the trend that I see that LC is local content. All these resources that I mentioned about in the library terms in Indonesia, we call that local content. This local content has made the boundaries between libraries, archives, and museum has become blurred. We cannot say exactly this is a library domain, this is archives domain. No, things are getting blurred. Okay, by that, I will end my presentation. Thank you.
Please introduce yourself.
Yes, I'm Jesse Vargas from UP Mindanao, University of the Philippines, Mindanao. I'm more interested in how do you manage to keep the original files of your digitized materials. Do you keep them, or say a historian wants to access the original file? How do you, what are your policies? Because I believe that it is more important than a digital file. So how do you manage? Does it pose management problems on your part?
Okay. You mean the original digital file?
No, the original file in which the hard file, the physical file.
Okay. As I mentioned that we developed the collection with the help of the people of Surabaya. So most of the old pictures, we don't own the hard copy collection. It's the people that lend their personal collection to us. But we have one requirement that everything that's that will go into the Surabaya memory, the owner of the resources have to sign an agreement that they would let us to share these resources to everyone. So it's like an open access. Everyone can have the digital collection. If not, then we don't want to have the resources into our system, because there's no use to keep something that cannot be used. Why keep something that's just for the sake of keeping?
This is actually a follow-up question. How do you digitize a not linear or 2D materials like paper, like a basket? Do you have in your website a 3D perspective?
Okay, we usually take a digital photography method. Yeah. But if it is a two-dimensional, we use scanners as much as possible because it produces better quality images. But otherwise, we should use digital photography.
Terima kasih.
Thank you. Wow. Maybe one more question on the floor. Yes, man at the back.
I really like your presentation. I am impressed with your giving emphasis on photographs to understand settlements. It's not a question, but I think, I don't know, I would like to get your opinion. This is how I think. Can we use like the one you're using to use local knowledge to understand our urban landscapes? Like my interest, I capture it in your photographs. For example, settlement sites. I only pick up photographs in local communities of Cebu, like looking at settlements where the old elite are. But I have never come up into my mind how to use the local knowledge in understanding the urban landscapes. And I would like to get your opinion if those photographs can be actually used in understanding the greater landscape in urban development.
Okay. Well, I might not be the perfect person to answer because I'm not the architect or city planning, but I would suggest that we could, just like the previous presentation mentioned about the importance of involving local people in creating the resources so that we can also capture some of the local knowledge that's available there that will not be able to be captured digitally in the form of digital photograph. Is that what you're...
Yeah. Actually, I get interested. Everybody, I think, yeah, most of us know Dr. Isel Muharis. I come up with his material on where is, I think that the title, if I'm not mistaken, where is the center that is looking at Cebu province and looking at Karkar as an old elite community. But it is never, the documentation of settlements of the elite group is not actually bridged into the understanding of the urban development of Cebu. And it is very striking by just using photographs in the local settlements. I think it could reconstruct back how things are actually being developed.
Okay, maybe it's not possible to really construct back what it has been in the past, but at least what I would suggest is that to add more of a social networking function on the system so that it will allow as many as possible people who has the knowledge about that subject to give comments in which, in the end, it will give a more complete picture, quote-unquote, about the picture.
All right, thank you very much, Mr. Aditya Nugraha from Petra Christian University of Leadership.